Hi, I'm David Stein of Money for the Rest of Us, and in this video, I explain why the US dollar is not going to crash. The economist Peter Schiff was recently on the Joe Rogan Experience podcast and YouTube channel. And on there, Schiff said the US economy would enter into a deep recession before the end of Trump's first term. And as a result, asset prices would fall and the dollar would become a bottomless pit. No one would want to own it. No one would want to own any assets denominated in the US dollar. Why does he believe that? Well, his main concern is he believes that the Federal Reserve created too much money as part of their quantitative easing program. And that has led to asset price inflation, that investments, stocks have gone up in price, art has gone up in price, bonds have gone up in price. And he believes that as the economy slows, that we'll continue to have high inflation, that asset inflation will move over to higher prices in the grocery store and at the gas station. When you have high inflation during an economic recession, that is called stagflation. And it's really, really rare. The only time that I know we've had stagflation was in the 1970s. Now, here's where I think Schiff is wrong. The money supply in the United States has increased. And when we're talking about money supply, we're talking about M2, which is a measure of cash, checking deposits, and savings deposits. And that has increased pretty significantly. Over the past 3 years through June 2018, the money supply has increased by 5.9%. That's been the average annual increase over the past 3 years. And the consumer price index, the measure of inflation over the past 3 years, has been 1.9%. Now, if we compare that to the period of stagflation in the 1970s, from 1974 to 1977, the three-year average increase in the money supply, again, we're talking about checking accounts, savings accounts, and cash, that was around 10 to 14% per year. So more than double what we have today. And inflation was over 10%. Now, what was different from the 1970s is we were much more dependent on oil, and there were capacity constraints. There was an inability because of high oil prices to produce the goods and services that we need. Now, in today's environment, in order to have inflation, you need constrained capacity, the ability of businesses to produce goods and services. They need to be running full out tilt. That's not where we're at today. In fact, Peter Schiff believes employment in the US, unemployment is understated, that there's a lot of workers out there that want to work, but can't find the jobs, or they're working part-time and they want to work full-time. In other words, there's an excess of workers. If we have an excess of workers, that is not a condition that leads to inflation. The other thing to consider is even as the money supply has increased much less than the 1970s, one reason is the Federal Reserve did not create a bunch of money and send it out into the economy. All they did is they bought bonds in the open market and swapped them. It was an asset swap. They bought bonds from a household, and instead that investor got some cash and put it in the bank, or maybe they bought another asset with it. If it's an asset swap, if I exchange an apple for an orange, there's not more fruit in the economy. There's just a swap of assets. And so we've not had that significant increase of the money supply from the Federal Reserve. The reason why the money supply has increased at all is because banks increased their lending. The amount of loans in the US economy, private sector debt, has gone from about $23.5 trillion in 2010 to around $29 trillion today. So about a $6 trillion increase. Those increased loans means more money in the economy, and that has allowed for a little bit increase in inflation, but not high inflation. And when the economy slows, that means businesses will be less likely to borrow, and there'll be less money created, and there'll be slack in the economy. which means businesses might actually lower prices in order to try to spur demand. And that would be deflationary or disinflationary rather than inflationary. So the bottom line is, I don't think we're going to get stagflation because the money supply has by no means increased the same rate it did in the 1970s, and we don't have the capacity constraints that we would need for inflation. Now, Schiff recommends investing in other economies, such as Switzerland, Singapore, and New Zealand. And the thing to remember is the dollar can only crash relative to other currencies. So other countries have to be worse off than the US. And those countries actually have higher private sector debt balances relative to GDP than the US. In other words, they're more indebted than the US. Their economies aren't necessarily in better shape, and so their currency isn't necessarily going to strengthen relative to the dollar. And also during global recessions, investors tend to flock to dollar assets, to government bonds, because there's a flight to quality, there's safety, and that tends to strengthen the dollar, just like the US dollar is strengthening today. So I do not believe during the next recession that the dollar will crash. If anything, the dollar will strengthen relative to other currencies. You don't have to worry about it. Now, if you are worried about it, there is one recommendation that Schiff recommended. It was to buy gold. Gold, as Jim Grant says, is an option on the unexpected. It can protect your portfolio if we get some inflation. But gold is a speculative asset, so you shouldn't have more than really 5% of your portfolio in gold. That's about what I have in my portfolio, just to protect against the unknown. The dollar, in my opinion, is not going to crash. And if it does, well, I do have some gold to protect against that. If you have any questions or comments, you can put them below. Thanks.